Just get over yourself. Hang on a sec. Preparing to live stream the webinar. Do, 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 do. And then I have to switch it off because then I can hear myself in surround and then we will start properly.
Then we'll start the best homosexual occult show in the world.
All right, I'm going to close that one down. Very good. Connor, how are you? Hey, boo.
Hey, babes. Hi. Oh my gosh, I haven't seen you in so long.
I know. Let's start there. I mean, how is your year? Perfect? 9 out of 10? 10 out of 10?
20 out of 20. So zero. What an incredible year. What an absolutely incredible year. And I mean, obviously, you know, problems and intensities and stuff like that. But I mean, I keep thinking what a moment to be alive, you know, that we get to have this and experience this. And I've got to tell you, like, for me, it's been okay. it's been pretty good. But that's because it didn't change what my task was, you know? I mean, I don't always know what my task is, but I always know to do it. And I think for a lot of people that are in that spiritual space, that's how they experience the year. It was just keep with the task, keep going. So, yeah.
Yeah, it was an awesome year in the sense of being filled with awe. It was like an Old Testament year of like, oh, wow, this is happening now.
Right. Oh, that shit's really going down. Right. Like, but I mean, there was that, right? Like the fact that a lot of people, it just felt like people were just fucking around till now in a lot of ways. And you got to see, especially at the beginning of, you know, the global crisis, like who meant it. And I think that's something that brought, I know you and I both, because we had talked about it, like a bit of sorrow and a bit of pain and a feeling of isolation sometimes was like, oh, maybe people don't actually believe the things that they say they believe. And therefore, some of the people either in our audience or allies or friends actually are not on this playing field with us, or they're not on the same page as us. And that felt intense. And there was some mourning around that. But also, I was happy to have that revealed, you know?
Yeah, I think I'm there now. Like, but I mean, we should expand on that. So do you think they didn't believe, is it a question of their dumbness or is it a question of their disingenuity? Do you know what I mean? Like, do they not believe it or do they not have the skills to believe it? Do you know, like, that's actually kind of different. And I'm not sure, right. I think both are in play, but right. I mean, what was your experience of it?
Yeah, there are certainly people who were revealed to be stupid this year, but I think it's more, more, you know, you understand that one of the first steps that we take on a magical or spiritual or cult path is an intellectual one. And I think sort of seeing, oh, a lot of people had only taken that step because it is a step outside of the narrative. You move past it with a thought, not your thinking, but your thoughts. And, you know, I think for a lot of people that appeared to them to be actually a way that they had become freed from the narrative or free from the constitutive forces of this moment. But actually it's not, it requires quite a bit more than that. And we're all, I mean, you and I think are subject to those forces too. It's not speaking out of an egotistical place. It's just that it requires more than just thinking and having intellectual, ideological concepts.
Yeah, it's hard one. I like the difference between a thought and a thinking, because that's very animist, right? Which is you can have the thought that you are countercultural or freed from the official view of reality. You can have that thought, but that's different to thinking in a way that is free of the official view of reality. Like that thought is in fact contained within the official view of reality, just on the edge of it, where you can kind of perform in the negative sense, because I'm actually pro performance, but like perform in the negative sense a simulation of independence. And I think people have, I think more people than I expected are trapped in that pseudo paradise.
Yeah, and that feeling brought me a lot of pain, I would say, or sadness. I mean, as it always does when you feel like, oh, am I alone in the room?
Yeah.
Now, you know?
Yes.
And then unfortunately, like what that also meant was, and we'll go deeper into this, I think, is there are a lot of people who also thought that they were outside of the narrative that weren't. So you could be around people that is seemingly were like, well, I'm not one of the sheeple. Do you know what I mean? But they were just repeating another version of the narrative that was going on and the forces that were going on. I noticed also like the way it revealed last year and the year before. Like, here's a great example. There was a video recently of a nurse from Tennessee who got a vaccine, and she developed, or in this video, for the sake of YouTube, in the video, it said that she developed Bell's palsy. Now, whatever we think about the reality of the video, or the reality of getting Bell's palsy from an mRNA vaccine, and some people who were in the trials for the vaccine did get Bell's palsy, although they say it's not connected. She's sitting in the video. She's a Black woman. She's crying. She's just like really, really upset. I mean, it's a disturbing video to watch. And she is saying, I wouldn't wish this on anybody. Now, all the truth claims of that aside, I wondered where all the people in 2019 were who would have defended a Black woman crying on the internet.
Yeah.
Right? It just revealed very quickly how actually false their narrative from last year, or well, two years ago now, was as well. Actually, you didn't really think we need to believe Black women when they come forward with pain, because you have a larger narrative which is overriding that one. And so I think it's that kind of upsetting. And again, it's not a comment on whether, I have no idea whether or not the video is real, but it does reveal what was happening before.
And is this, I think that's, because we're coming back to, are they dumb or are they, you know, deliberately mean-spirited? And I think in that case, it's dumb and fear-based, right? So, what we're seeing, and this is astrologically to be expected, but we're sort of seeing the end of, and the only thing that could destroy a materialist naturalist understanding of progressivism is progressivism itself. Like, it's not even, I think it was Thaddeus, but it was someone like that who said it's not even left anymore. And I think that's fair. I think it's descended into this superstitious cult in the belief in the all power of the state. And it shouldn't be, like, it should, well, I mean, it can be that, but progressivism should have optimization built into it, because the idea is that it relies on ever improving data for the moral and physical improvement of a population. And you can disagree with that as a goal politically if you want, but this isn't it. This is just the wrong kind of Black woman. So she doesn't get any support, right? So you can support Black women sharing their experience on the internet as long as it's an allowed experience. And, you know, that's trapped in a pseudo version of it. And I think
now, if they would have just played Lemonade behind that video,
yeah,
it would have
been there you fun. Go.
Everybody would have been like, oh, great. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, she has like a Kamala poster behind her. Like,
right. Right. Exactly.
And I just wonder. So it started off for me anyway, because I don't know, not a coward, but it started off for me with a lot more hostility than I have at the moment. And I think it's because a bunch of people who are operating in that space of fear have shut the fuck up because they have potentially caught up. I'm not expecting any apologies anytime soon, although I deserve them. What I think that means is the ones that are left are the nastiest, right? So there's sort of like fewer incoherent shitlib narratives, but they're louder and nastier. And it looks like kind of classic early 20th century psychology to me, which is that ever increasing urgency to retain a complex that explains the world. And I think that's going to suck for them. As by the end of 2021, they will have either gone insane from the dissociation between this frame they have for the world and what's actually happened. And it just seems like the sooner people do that work, not just better for the world, but better for their ability to navigate it. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I that's almost the hopeful view of it, I would say. I mean, I think, unfortunately, the forces, the adversarial forces that are at play are encouraging that, right? And so, so what's happening right now is that, we've sort of touched on this already, but there's a problem of certainty, of ideological certainty. And the fact of the matter is, none of us are certain what's happening. None of us are certain what's happening. We don't have the total picture. We might have parts of it that are true, but, you know, to the extent that we begin to extend ourselves into speculation and asserting that with absolute certainty, we're contributing to the problem, right?
Yes.
And so, but what's happening is everything that's coming in this year and some years beyond that will be a problem will have to do with the poisonous concept of community, because community right now is the real danger, which it sounds so counterintuitive to people. But what's happening is within communities, people actually are generating love for each other. They're meeting in love. They're taking care of each other. Like, for instance, there was this, I think it was a Tucker Carlson thing on this town that had lost so many people to the opioid crisis in the Midwest. And they had put up this monument to the people that had died and all that. And so they're really loving each other and caring for each other. And also then sort of hating pharmaceutical companies, hating the state, all that kind of stuff, and coming together. And yet, of course, you drop like a trans person in that community and they're like fucked, right? So like they're sharing love within the community. Right. It won't be the an episode of
Pull Up in Your Car,
Naked and Afraid, but yeah, right. But the idea is the love within the community is surrounded by the ossified membrane of ideology. So even though there's real love happening within the community, it's the actual inverse of the Christian message, which is where two or more are gathered in my name, you know, there will be. It's two or more people are gathering for love that's so encased that it actually turns into hate. And so, you know, this is where, I mean, there's so many comparisons to like Nazism and Nazi Germany, but this is where I actually find an extension of Nazi ideology, which is, and that also includes not just people who are suspicious of the opioid crisis, but like rabid, like scold your neighbors for not wearing a mask and going out, kind of stuff, right? Right. So this is where it's an extension of Nazism. Albert Speer describes this thing where he says, you know, the way the Nazis worked were you would have a person sitting at a desk completing one task and another task and another task. And they never looked over at what their neighbor was doing. And each task was kind of bound up. Right. So the Nazis, what they tried to do was to utilize individuals that had no contact with other individuals and were just sort of doing their own thing. And there was no penetration of the border of the task. The extension of that now is that communities are loving each other, looking at their neighbors, but they're bound within this membrane of ideology, which is very stone-like, and they're not looking at any other communities. And so their communities are becoming the wellspring of evil. And so we've got to be careful about that, because knowledge and certainty is done, actually. And this was the blessing of fake news and post-truth and all that. What matters now is taking an interest in the other, which is a completely different thing.
Yeah, it's funny, after, you know, 4 years of literally a Nazi and out he goes and we get actual Nazism, because that I think that's the use of isolation. Well, it's funny, it's a progressive thing, right? But the boundaries of community are biologically drawn at the moment, and I would argue pseudo-biologically drawn, hence Nazism, right? So the apps that will let you go into the supermarket and not are entirely there. So yeah, community is this Borg-like I like it. It's a good read. It's a good read that the notion of it as we experience it is not, not to be rose-tinted about it. The Paleolithic experience of tribal life, it is community in a synthetic or spreadsheet way, and that does ossify it. It's actually anti-life, right, rather than, and I have anti-life and pro-life, and then I say the words pro-life and I'm like not quite like that.
Pro-lives matter. Yeah. I think I know what you're saying. It is an anti-life like equation. It's an anti-humanity and pro-humanity, yeah, we could say. And so yeah, so what's happening is, and why I said, oh, that's a hopeful read, is that the adversarial forces are encouraging us to cloister in these communities that are bound because, one, you can sell things, you can read the algorithm better, and most importantly, you can turn human beings into objects. Yes. Or you can turn them in, you can turn communities into objects that look like they have human beings in them instead of automaton that are just there to keep adding stones to the wall.
I love it. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's Catherine Fitz said something which I like, which is, think of it as the goal is to try to get humanity to resonate with the cloud rather than with the living field. Right. So if in every sense, it's that kind of synthetic contact replacing authentic relationality. And I think if this is, so I remember I'd done an email, by the way, just before, which I thought was a sync, but we did a show about biopolitics halfway through the year. So 15 years ago. and is this
15 gay couple years ago?
Yeah. Or one lesbian date.
Right. Time works differently for us.
So yeah. This was self-evident to us the whole way through. And is it as simple as I had read Foucault before it happened? Like I don't want to reduce it all down to Foucault, but I mean that we did biopolitics and colonialism as a thing at university, and I stuck with it. It's not like I just learned that and remembered. Although actually, when I put that post together, I did in fact have to go, it's been a while. It's been a while since, yeah, I've thought of this, because it just seems like that used to be something I thought that would ideologically go along with, dare I say, something like progressivism. But now now progressivism is this sort of mouth-watering, slavish, unpaid policeman behavior for a international corporate state, right? And you know, this is not how I remember critiquing bodies. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, look, it's like Foucault entered your karma stream in a different way than it did other people's. I mean, that's just simply the fact of it. You are someone who is, or at least became, I don't know where you were when you're reading Foucault. were you a weird undergrad? Where you were when you read Foucault, but it entered into your karma line, which was, oh, yeah, to spiritualize the thing that you read. I mean, unfortunately, Foucault himself was not there, right? Like, yeah, he couldn't redeem his own work, right? And like a lot of these postmodern or critical theorists or whatever, or, you know, Slovenian school people like Žižek and so forth, they make the most profound points, but they can't actually see like the truth in what they're saying. And so they need to be actually redeemed by spiritually minded people who don't take materialism as the correct starting point. I mean, even like people who are rabidly materialist, Adorno, Horkheimer, like, you know, Frankfurt School people, that they're actually quite beautiful and profound, but they just can't access it themselves. And so, and I mean, a lot of that is just because they're reacting towards the mysticism and occultification of, you know, the Nazis and the way that they controlled people. So, you know, one can barely blame them in some way. But, you know, so I think that that's it. It's not that you read it first. It's that you read it. You read what was actually there.
Yeah.
You know, yeah.
Obviously, I read it early noughties at university, and that was coming out of 90s chaos magic phase. So I'm reading it going, Chaos Magic hadn't realized that this is in fact the theoretical backstory behind it, certainly 90s version of chaos magic. So it did allow me to, I guess, operationalize it in a way that I kind of overread what was in there. But even without it, even just a standard, like even classic post-colonial text will give you a critique on things like Western corporations helicoptering into brown countries and mandating medicines, right? Like, what the fuck? Yeah. This is never, this has a dangerous history. That kind of like biological improvement of the other while still otherizing. Like it's sort of a biological reification of center and edge. And it's you're injecting global capitalism. It's mental.
Yeah, but it's also, I mean, also, you know, one of the aspects of this pandemic, I talked about this with John Tenney on my show, the supernatural or paranormal investigator, but you know, he made this great point about Arthur Machen's book, The Great God Pan, coming out almost 100 years ago, and how that is about someone who their eyes open up and they can see the spiritual world and its proximity and they go crazy, right? And what's happening now in a pandemic is that, you know, so this with a medicalized procedure and the totalitarianism of medicalization of the world, where I don't even mean the vaccine. I mean, we're all focused on public health. So there's a totalizing field of, so to look into that is to go crazy. You have to look sideways. And the reason why is that there's the approach of spiritual being. And I will just, you know, I mean, I usually avoid naming it, but it's become now necessary, this, you know, being Ahriman. And the Ahrimanic forces that are approaching, they're also just pulling people in. So it's not just like, oh, we read it and we got it and we were spiritually active, like I just said. That was bullshit, Connor, say something different. Which is also like people are being pulled in, like, you know, like magnetically pulled in. And so there's an intensification of the, you know, counter forces. So, I mean, it's also in some ways not really people's fault, you know, like yes, it can make them forget. I mean, people can't remember what they did 10 minutes ago when they're looking on their phones. So why would they remember Foucault, you know?
Yeah. I think there's, and it's funny when I say mind control, I mean, there probably is some sort of that extreme CIA style stuff in small amounts somewhere where you can kind of, and have been able to since the 70s, physically control the person. But mind control is more cosmic in the sense of, I don't think people, I think they're trapped. I think they're trapped by a world story that emanates from an entity, right? So even at the top, so it's kind of like difficult to even blame like Klaus Schwab and Bill Gates in that sense, because they're totally manifestations of something underneath it. But it also comes back to the, again, we'll speech mark toxicity, but the the rankness of community, because I think this is what has hollowed out progressivism and turned it into, which is resonating with a community of force and actually enjoying the application of state power because you've identified with it as a community thing. So it's almost like another, it's like a diffuse nested, do you know what I mean? So it does pull people in. It pulls people into, I think, and this is from the very beginning, this is a separate thing. I guess we can use it to pivot to 2021 in a way. I found people's fear is a pseudo enchantment. It is a pseudo re-enchantment of your world to participate in a fear event, particularly one that isn't exactly or at all in your lived experience. So some health incidents for people in care homes in Canada or whatever isn't in your experience as a 25-year-old. Mm-hmm. But you have the opportunity to participate and enchant the quotidian with the extreme, and it's the it's a pseudo enchantment because you actually can do that because the universe is alive. You actually can participate in wonder rather than fear, and it's still, because I think people have the fall for the pseudo enchantment because they don't have the wonder. And so it's very appealing to fall into a narrative that is cosmic in scope. But you are already in a narrative that is cosmic in scope because you are in the cosmos. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. I mean, great, the great way to say it, right? Like, because, like, you know, like Richard Dawkins and people like that, who just seem now like they're from a different dimension at this point, but they, you know, like they would say like, oh, science brings wonder to us. It brings wonder. But actually it's just the dead ending of, you know, wonder into a product essentially, you know, or a kind of brand. It's, you know, it's like being hyper aroused by a girl in a bikini on a billboard, you know, and then instead of jerking off buying beer, because that's what it told you to do. Like that's what wonder, that's what, you know, the planet Earth, you know, hosted by Neil deGrasse Tyson or whatever that dude's, that loser's fucking name is. We're just saying like, sorry, but it's just being like the wonder of the planet Earth, science, you know, it's like, fuck off. You're just selling a brand, like, you know, at this point. And so that's it. Like the wonder gets dead ended. It's not really opening anything at all because of, there's gravity. There's gravity pulling you away from actually continuing along the path. I mean, and you know, science is fine. That's all sorts of great things for us. But you know what I mean? Yeah,
definitely. It what they're talking about isn't it anyway, and you kind of have to save it by making it the right size again. And it comes back to, you know, I was thinking about this. I mentioned in I have a show coming out. I'm on THC, I think, this week, whatever, with Greg. And anthropologist Graham Townsley was talking about the Yamanahua, and in particular their shamanism. And he said, shamanism isn't a collection of facts known. It's an assembly of techniques for knowing. Mm-hmm. And I think this is kind of the energy I'm taking into 2021, because it's not just the shorter planning cycles that I was talking about with Austin, although it is that, because it's an assembly of techniques for knowing. This is the science and wonder thing. You have to consent to facts. So like if you have a cosmology that's based on a shared agreement on facts, what you're actually doing is making the, forcing people into declaring this epistemology or even just metaphysics true, or they don't even get to play. And so I think that's trapped a bunch of people. It's trapped a bunch of magic people too. I think they're doing magic, but they've already consented to a materialist, naturalist framework to live in. So it's this weird collection of consent to facts. And I just think people who kind of can't make that barrel roll out are going to really struggle with the next couple of years, because the shamanic approach of it being an assembly of techniques for knowing rather than a collection of facts, it comes back to like collection of facts is takes on a vaccine, right? Assembly of techniques for knowing is how you navigate the end of a lot of frameworks we previously thought were fixed. And I think that's like the better way through the jungle. What do you reckon?
Yeah. I mean, it's you know, the thing that you're talking about with facts, that's just a version of object thinking, you know, like you just, so facts are objects, you know, so like, is it really non-materialist? It's the same thing, you know, like when people talk about clairvoyance, you know, they're like, oh, I'm clairvoyant. So I've moved beyond materialism. It's like, okay, so what's going on with your clairvoyance? Well, I can see someone picking up the necklace and putting it in the case, and the necklace is in the case, and that's where my friend lost his necklace. I'm like, okay, so you're still seeing objects, and you're still seeing things that are given to you by the empirical senses. You're still seeing matter in motion. So that's materialism. I don't give a shit if it's clairvoyance. Like, you're still doing materialism.
You're just doing it. It's still snakes and ladders to materialism, right?
So, exactly. Yeah. So it doesn't matter if you have a magical power that, you know, still just echoes all the versions and aspects of materialism. And you and I have talked about this in many ways in different forms, whether it's medicine or you know, and people get taking vitamin C instead of, you know, this whatever, and being like, I'm doing it the natural spiritual way. And it's like, no, you're just still taking a pill to address a disease process. Objective.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. So it's actually moving out of object thinking. And this is a very difficult thing, in fairness, a very difficult thing to explain to people. And I find it increasingly hard. The more my experience actually reflects that, it becomes increasingly difficult to describe, although I think I'm doing sort of okay with it. But yeah, I want to just go back to something that you said before, though, about the ways that people, like when you're talking about Thaddeus Russell saying it's not even left or right anymore.
No, he said progressive. I think it's, I don't want to put words in Thad's mouth specifically, but I was listening to someone like that who said progressivism isn't even left anymore.
Yeah.
And I'm I see. Yeah. And I'm like, it isn't. Like in terms of how I understand the left as a, you know, well, certainly at the moment, what passes for contemporary progressivism is the most successful attack on the working class.
100%
that has ever happened. And you know, so in that sense, I'm like, yeah, that's actually a good read. Progressivism and this sort of online scolding behavior of staying home while poor people bring you things is drastic. You know, the Tories could never.
We've set it up over time, right? And part of it is like, it's sort of what we've been talking about another way. Like when I was talking about reading Foucault and Foucault doesn't realize like actually the thing that's in his work. I mean, I'm not a big Foucault fan, but he doesn't realize the thing that's in his work that's actually a value. I could say Deleuze or someone like that. Yeah. But the thing is you like Marxism is like one of the best examples right now. People have just lost their fucking minds about Marxism and socialism, which have some value. But like now that people learned the word capitalism 2 years ago, like, you know, like their best response is this, like, almost completely irrelevant thing. And one of the reasons why it's irrelevant is like, they don't know where to contain the Marxist impulse. Actually the Marxist impulse, and this will wrap together, but the Marxist impulse is quite good in the political realm. Now, and the rights realm. And Marxists don't like saying that. They think that they have an economics critique, or they think that they can describe culture using Marxism. But actually the idea that all people should be treated equally and have equal rights, which is the underlying class labor analysis of Marxism, whether they agree with me or not, I don't give a fuck. Yeah. the idea in the political rights realm, that's correct. But what's happened is it gets knocked out and put into the cultural realm. And so there's this idea of all these identity politics are basically attempts to, not to say, I mean, I hate to say this because it sounds like cultural Marxism. I believe, of course, that trans people, gay people, black people, blah, blah, I believe all the things that I am and other people are deserve in the political rights realm, total equality. But it's been turned into a cultural argument, which is something completely different. And that's not cultural Marxism. That's actually the displacement of the good impulse of Marxism, which I agree with, into the wrong place. And so the reason why it relates to all the things we're talking about is like this, it's like we have the pieces that we need, but we keep misapplying them and we're putting them in the wrong places. Whereas like actually culture needs to be anarchist, you know, I mean, for it to actually work, right? Yeah. Culture needs to be anarchist. And so that's a completely different thing, but politics actually can't be anarchist. It needs to be Marxist or socialist in and of itself. But once you start exporting these pieces and putting them in the wrong places, you get a big problem, you know? So I think,
is there like an agentic read to that, right? So I'm not an accelerationist, but I had James from Hermetics on the show to talk about it. And the accelerationist idea, and I love the bit at the beginning because I've been using this like even at Christmas discussions with my family, because I'm sure everyone did. But the way you kind of bring people to a consensus at a time when consensus is effectively impossible is to say that literally no one is happy with the direction we're going. So everyone's, the boomers are pointing at China, you know.
They want that war. Yeah.
Marxists, anti-mask and mask people are yelling at each other. And so the best way to start a conversation like that is to say no one is happy with the direction we're going. And that appears to be systemic in my sense of the word, as in this is the inevitability of the system that we're in, rather than systemic in a kind of diffuse oppressive way, because there's a lot to say about that. And so do you think it's agentic? Because one of the things I liked about some of the accelerationists was this idea that, and it's what identity politics has done, but also this kind of like online version of Marxism, you can make the case, I don't, but you can make the case that it's sort of capitalism's attempt at doing what it does, which is to commodify and consume things that would potentially put it at risk, but now contain it as a reification thing. And it's not, I don't actually think that's what's going on, but I like that you can make an accelerationist critique that way so that you can have an agentic discussion about like who has misplaced the Marxism or has it been co-opted? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. So by agentic, just to be completely clear, you mean that people, like some people are actually doing it. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, because you said in your read, we are misapplying Marxism because we're applying it to culture rather than applying it in a political realm. But like, are we doing that? Is it just what happens now? Like that's the agent, like who are the agents in the misapplication of things that may be of use to us, but we're now at a point where, and this is where how civilizations collapse. Like it's never one thing. It's that we've hit a point where every single intervention makes it worse. Like this is what I like about accelerationism. So it doesn't matter, stop the steal or Zombie Joe. It doesn't matter who wins. The process of going through that is accelerationist in and of itself, right? And that's kind of, I find that really interesting because I want people, one of the priorities I want for people in early 2021 is to sit with agency, who has it, how you understand it, because solutionism is again part of the problem. So we need to be urgently aware of agency because we never don't have it, but the agency that we have is very often not the one that we think. We fall back onto techniques that I would consider to be wholly co-opted and certainly making it worse at this point.
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting because like, right, so the Jordan Peterson, Breitbart, whatever, like version of things is like, well, the Frankfurt School, in collaboration with these people, tried to create trans rights with Marxism, right? So stupid. I can't even like, even just saying that, like, that's what they actually fucking believe. It's so dumb. And so like, I don't think that, there's a misunderstanding of what human freedom is to begin with, right? First of all, we talk way too much about free will. You and I talked about this a long time ago on the show. We just said it for like, it was just like a little blip. It might even be the first time I was on RuneSoup, but it was something like, will is not the place to put all the magical energy, right? Yeah. We talk way too much about free will and not enough about free thinking, which is a completely, and not free thought, again, but free thinking and free feeling. And free will is, of course, important. But when we talk about freedom and who has the agency and all that kind of stuff, we have to realize that our baseline is actually not being free. We live in the forces of karma. Karma is... we can, of course, bring in, okay, karma and reincarnation, our past lives and what happens to us in our life between dying and being reborn. But we include in karma the family you were born into, the area you were born into, your body shape, whether or not you have all your fingers and toes, who's surrounding you, what, so on and so forth. You get it, right? So the constitutive forces of your being are not freedom. The groundswell of your being is determinism, but in
I would say inertia, but yes, like
right. Yes. So the way, you know, Rudolf Steiner addresses this and solves this problem very simply, and I love it. He says, you know, man. He said man, but whatever. Man is not free.
Just men. Carry on.
Yeah, he's just man. Man is not
the one
free.
Gender.
Exactly. Man is not free. He is on the way to becoming free. right? And so what happens in that is, like, you can imagine there's an air hole for a seal to come up in through the ice. And every once in a while, it comes up and it breathes. And that's freedom. We rise above the conditions of karma through thinking with intention, feeling with clarity, and acting purposefully. It's very rare that that happens. Very rare. And that includes for all the magically operative people you know in your life and all that kind of stuff and all the, you know, spiritual teachers and gurus that you listen to. It's very rare that we are free, but the capacity it grows every single time you surface for air, every single time. So the idea that the agency all belongs to this or that group of people, or that it merely belongs to the determined spirit world, are both, it's like a little bit of a jumble there, yeah. Right? Like, it's up to us, but it's very difficult for it to be up to us. Yeah.
No, I think it comes down to, even at a, first of all, I would say free thinking and free feeling would be examples of techniques for knowing. Mm-hmm. Emancipated thoughts or confident feelings would be facts known. So it's actually back into that shamanic way of being in the world. And as you say, it's rare, but it's that I think people get confused. And it comes back down to on a baseline thing of what you think a person is and how they're constituted. And obviously, from an animist perspective, they're constituted relationally, right? So that has agentic implications, which I don't see with people nodding along, at least on Twitter. But Twitter doesn't count as like a valid sample of reality anymore, because they're just saying things for clout, right? But be that as it may, to have an opinion on agency is to have formed consciously or not what you think a person is and what they're made of, right? Because this is sort of upstream really, or downstream, I guess, from will, because to then decide what is and isn't will is downstream from that, because free will is a thing that a free person has, and a free person is an individual. And it's this kind of back to Charles Eisenstein's idea of the story of separation. Like, it, you just end up in this fact known atomized way, which doesn't, speaking of science, is not actually found anywhere in science.
Yeah.
Science only finds relationality. And I think that's important, especially as it kind of infinitely contains and revivifies science, because it finds a thing that can't cleanly exist within it constantly. And I like that. I think that's actually the energy that keeps it small. Keep it small if we let it do it. But this kind of agentic discussion, everything very quickly gets to metaphysics, right? And if you're not doing it, you've inherited one, which is what you think a person is a question of how one acts, right? And that's why I've been, like, I had Dr. Bio Kumalafe on the show, one of my favorite episodes, I think, of the year of 2020, because it's just such a really good way of phrasing it. Like, what if the way we respond to the crisis is part of the crisis? And it's not that he's the first person to have said that, but it's just really pithy, like, and clever. And you can just pose that as this rhetorical, and I usually do after the kind of accelerationist thing of, like, no one is happy with the direction we're going. One, what if the way we respond to the crisis is part of the crisis? Two, and that I think has been, at least in the, Austin's going to hate this, in this age of Aquarius, it isn't, by the way, if you've just tuned in, but in this age of Aquarius, I think that's a really good way of tabling discussion, because it's like, well, no one's happy with the direction, and also every way we respond makes it worse. So we need, and this is the Donna Haraway stuff, new responsibility, right? New old hyphen responsibility. That's my what do you reckon?
So I like, one of the things about animism in the way you talk about it, which is of course very different than the way a lot of other people talk about it. There's so many different versions of it, but I really like this relationality aspect. Have any of you who are listening noticed, I'm sure you've noticed, and I certainly have, that you've had very strange health problems over the past couple of weeks. Very weird pains, heart issues, nausea, whatever it is. What's happening?
Put on a bunch of Christmas weight. What are you saying? this just sounds like what I've been eating the last 2 weeks.
So
have you all noticed? you're very fat.
Yeah. So, but have any of you noticed that part of what's happening right now is that there's actually a reconfiguration of the constitutive relational forces of the world. There's something's happening in the astral world, something's happening in the physical world, and the etheric, maybe not so much, but there's a reconfiguration of it. And so what's happening to a lot of us who are getting sort of fit, not feeling so well, is that imagine you're being cast out of your body and into those constitutive forces again, and then rewoven back into yourself, and again, and again, and again. If you imagine the image of a murmuration of starlings coming out and turning, and you see that shape, that's kind of what's happening to a lot of people's being right now, where they're actually all those relational forces that constitute individuality and the kind of void of you, those are being reworked. And so a lot of people who are spiritually sort of activated or have a purpose, or who perhaps will have a purpose, are being thrown out into those forces, reworked and brought back into themselves. And so that's part of this animist picture as well. It's like you can, in your own body with your weird unexplainable symptoms that you've never had before, notice that actually things are being sort of reworked, thrown, cast out and brought back in and reworked. And you're experiencing that as discomfort in a lot of different ways.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be astrologically timed and sort of a good way of sitting with it. Actually, this is a sidebar, but when I was doing the ancestral remediation and healing work with Daniel Four last year in Melbourne, he said he was taught by a bon shaman how you should experience the spirits when you call them. It was in the context of a Four Directions thing, but he said you experience the spirits as basically hundreds of little birds, like a murmuration coming at you from that direction and around. And that was one of the techniques of starting to feel their experience. So there you go. That's a little bon shaman technique for you.
Augury. Yeah. Augury. Looking at the birds to understand. Yeah. It's really, yeah.
Cool. So we've got one question in the Q&A as we move into 2021 discussions. I thought I should mention for people in the chat, if you do have questions or commentary or so on, drop them in the Q&A. But Connor, for you, what are your personal, it's so weird after just saying that about blah, blah, capitalism and everyone saying Marxism wrong and all the rest of it. It's very difficult not to, I didn't want to say what are your goals for 2021, because that word almost belongs in the old world. So it's like, what are your 2021 personal priorities, which is a redescription that's almost as unsatisfying, but not quite. But like, what are your... What's in your intendings and ongoings for 2021?
Yeah, I mean, I said this last year at the beginning of the year as well, where I remember you and Austin were talked about like just the shit storm that was coming in 2020. And I remember like right off, I was like, no, you can still do lots of cool stuff this year. You just have to sort of know who you are and like what you're good at and just really push on that. And you know what I mean? And I think that that's true for this year as well. It's like, you know, now is the time to sort of deepen capacity and express from there. So I think that that's, I mean, I have spiritual tasks to do in this country, and I've begun to understand it more and more and more. That's been one of the great gifts of 2020, is that it's really deepened my understanding. So, you know, but as usual, one does not want to get too specific with these things publicly, you know, until they're happening, you know what I mean? So,
I am going to open a bar in Iceland.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I do want to say something, about the year ahead for everybody. And I want to say something about vaccines. Here we go. Jenny McCarthy. No. I want to say something about vaccines, and because this is a challenge that most of us are going to have to engage with in one way or another. And some of us want that, you know, like the guy on Scruff today that I saw that said, hot for vaccines, or the
the ones like stay home. And I'm like, why is your dot green?
Right.
I'm not hooking up at the moment. I'm like, yeah.
Stay the fuck at home. So yeah.
Just delete the fucking app. That's what you were talking about before totally. This happened. Looking for a reason to delete this app.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. How about a pandemic? If that's what you believe.
Yeah.
So
you're cluttering up my grid with your nonsense.
Totally. So, you know, and then also the guys with the masks in their profile picture, like, don't pretend that that's just so you don't have to do a face pic. Like,
correct, please. Correct. Right? Those are the ones that are clearly 50 plus without the age on the profile. Good to totally. See how the Irish grid is as I remember it.
Right. It's just like the same. The people are like, oh, I'm walking on the other side of the street because I'm social distancing, not because those are two black people walking down this side. Yeah. Right. So anyway, so vaccines. So this is a challenge that we all have to face. And I want to give people something to consider because there's so much talk about the mRNA vaccine and what that's going to do to people and and vaccines in general. And people have been talking about sigils being inscribed on bits of the vaccine that will like be injected in your body or RFID chips or blah, blah. The problem with this implementation of vaccination, no matter what, is that the lie is the foundation of the implementation of the vaccine. Now, I'm not making a comment on the dangers of the vaccine in general, because I don't know, but that's the point. The truth is that neither do the companies that are administering it. Right. So the AstraZeneca one's a little bit different, but when these companies decide to administer the vaccine, what they could be saying that, I mean, you know, they would never say this, but what they could be saying is, look, a lot of us that work for these companies believe that this will help in this moment. And yet we don't actually know if, because we've never done the kind of long-term testing that we do on these. Do you want to be part of this experiment? Because this is the experiment, this is the gamble, this is what we're doing. And we don't know, but maybe this is our best shot, right? Now, look at that statement that I just made and compare it to what's being presented to everybody. In a way, the vaccine, because the foundation is the presence of unearned and untruthful certainty, it's a reverse communion. The blood is being transubstantiated into a drunkenness on a certainty that's not there, a clarity that's not there. And because the administration of it is built upon a lack of clarity that's disguised as clarity, what does that do to the world? And what message does that inscribe onto the earth through us going along with it? So instead of focusing, as a lot of people are, and I think, you know, go ahead and focus on this if you want, but it'll drive you crazy because this is looking directly into the spirit. Instead of focusing on whether or not this is going to kill you or give you Bell's palsy or any of that kind of stuff, what about getting clear in your thinking and clear in your feeling and clear in your will about what's happening when you imbibe this and what that's doing as a collective effort? When you're imbibing the false certainty as an aspect of truth when it's not true. So I think that actually transforms what happens in you also. I think that is true of medicine, and we need to discuss that. I mean, and so that's the challenge ahead of us, and the ways that that disguises so many things and the ways that those kinds of facts have been disguised all along, like, oh, ICUs and hospitals are being overwhelmed. Okay. Can we talk about why a 4% increase in some places is overwhelming a hospital? Why should that be so? So none of the facts of just the completely broken care system are ever brought up, and they're drowned in quantitative clutter. And so it creates a sense of false certainty that disguises the compassion that we need to lend to one another. So I just want to say, if the entire planet is going to engage in a reverse communion moment, we might want to think about what that signifies. Yeah.
In May,
and that doesn't mean don't take it. Sorry, I just want to say, I'm not saying don't take it.
It's, this is a really good opportunity for finding where you do and don't have agency, right? Because in May, when I put together a bunch of material for people to kind of get through this great reset, one of the things that occurred to me back then, which is bearing out now, is that coming back to Fort, Charles Fort, this is the process which is the only thing that can dismantle the dominant of science that we're moving out of. And he doesn't just mean science ends. He means the way that we make things true is this process. And what you're saying, that like, and this will kill it, because they're already in California, about 50% of healthcare workers are like, I'm not, in the same way I don't need to take a menopause medication. Mm-hmm. I don't need this. And so they're correctly assessing what you're saying there, which is like the truth claims that are coming with this don't match reality. So mm-hmm. it's a baseline about how we make things true. And it's Luciferian in its confidence, or demiurgic in its confidence. Mm-hmm. It's like, this is perfect for all time. It's like, but it's not, like, you can't say that. Mm-hmm. The problem is in you saying it, not whether or not it's true. And that's really, this is happening in, as we're seeing with, particularly in the US, but eventually the rest of us. This same process is reorganizing politics for what's next. So the things that are true in politics are ending because we are looking at yes. them and making a decision for ourselves. And it's the same for, it's how we make things true in reality. And this should be, and it is for some of us like us, but there should be the magician's wheelhouse. And it turns out, no, they're being crunched by it in very large numbers too. But this uh-huh. is a 2021 thing. You are not even invited. You are now being instructed mm-hmm. to sit down mm-hmm. and I keep going back to the Indiana Jones example of like Lost Ark. Like, now it's a question of what you believe. You're mm-hmm. there with all the grails, right? What do you think is true? Because you now have to live it. You have to live it.
Yeah, it's really well said. I mean, if you think about the movement from sort of pre-Nixon politics, where people all believed in politicians. I mean, not always, but we all believed in politicians. We thought that they had our best interest. And then at a certain point, some of them lied publicly, and we were like, okay, they lied, but they'll be held accountable. And it's somewhere in that transformation, there came a point mm-hmm. where now people say all politicians lie. That's just part of it, right? That's actually far worse than believing they're all telling you the truth, because yes. you've swallowed and imbibed the lie. So that's the problem here, is that, and look at the political field now, because we allowed that to happen. It's yep. not necessarily a statement on the truth or the lie or whatever. It's just, what are we accepting and allowing into ourselves and permanently? And that was yep. so difficult to dislodge. I mean, I think about this in terms of sex all the time. When we lose, we really fucking lose. So like, we lost the battle with sex, probably, I mean, there are different examples of it, but probably in the fucking Council of Trent, when the Catholic Church decided to fight against the Protestants by painting towels over dicks in their frescoes and shit like that, right? We've been having the echo of that sex shaming in a huge religious war over versions of God for hundreds of years now. And so the words that people speak about sex are from the 16th, 17th century. So do we want now the words that come out about medicine and health to be echoes of 2020? Or do we want to actually have a real picture? And it's really important. It's more important where you line up with the picture than it is what you actually do with your body. And I know that's really hard for people to take on, but that's part of getting out of the materialistic worldview.
100%, because this process is happening. I would describe it as moving from, you know, to the next dominant, but it's the exact same thing. This process is happening. You are called to, and it's not, as you say, it's not even what you put in it. It's how you are in relation to the universe mm-hmm. Needs to be the next thing. Because this one is ending, and that's why it's unavoidable in 2021. Like, our methods of truth making are destroying themselves in their overconfidence and overapplication. And if you adhere to that, you will be destroyed with the outgoing system. Or, and this is the good part about agency, you can just not. You can just not. And it's a separate process to taking experimental gene therapy or whatever. It is living in the new dominant that is arriving, and in doing so, ending the old one. And that's a different description of saying moving out of materialism, because the dominant of science is materialist naturalism.
Mm-hmm. Right. I think, you know, you and I have talked about this. I think every single show we've ever done, we've said, talk to the dead, right? And one of the reasons why you want to talk to the dead is to understand that death is not the end, you know? And once you get that, then you have a different picture of health. I mean, it's quite simple, you know? Once you know that death is not oblivion, and that that narrative is just preposterous, then you have a different picture of what health and life and mean. And so there's a really profound movie. I mean, it's boring, but it's amazing.
Professor Meet the Clumps?
Yeah, Dr. Doolittle. But all the Dr. Doolittles. No, A Hidden Life. It's a Terrence Malick movie. And in it, there's a small village, I think in Austria, and it's a farming village, and it's during World War II. And the men in the village are called up to become Nazis, and blonde hair, blue eyes, you know. And one guy refuses. Essentially, he's imprisoned, and they keep showing him, and they keep showing his family and what they're going through with all the pressure in the village, right? This movie came out last year, so it's a perfect movie to watch right now, because everybody's pressuring his family, and they're pressuring him to do one thing. But one of the most striking things is everybody, the town priest, his neighbors, the Nazi officers, so on and so forth, they keep saying, do you really think that this will have any effect on the outcome of what happens in the world? Just you here, don't you see? And of course, it's the only thing that does.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Absolutely the only thing that has effect. So we need to be clear. And there's a beautiful moment where he says something like, you know, once the fear of death and fight for survival leaves, a new light rushes in. And so we need to experience that new light within ourselves. Yeah.
Well, in Nutty Professor 2, Meet the Clump.
In Flubber.
It's funny, like, so returning to the dead thing, it's almost in this context, it's a subset of a, when you move into, if you live in a universe that is alive, one of the things is how you are constituted as a person. But once you are constituted as that person, there are the immediate thing of meaning and agency, and the only thing that works is on that level, is on a relational level rather than a scaling up to an abstracted idea of power and participating in it, right? So there's that bit of it, but the other, what comes with that, and it's sort of returning to how we move from one dominant to the next, is that in a universe of meaning, disease is a communication. So disease is a call to return to right relation, whatever it happens to be. And the disease that kills you, whatever it is, because it will, even if it's just old age, or it'll be heart disease or whatever, will call you to meaning in a really immediate way, because it's going to kill you, right? So it's going to like bring you to like, well, your physical form is ending and I'm taking it, right?
Yeah.
All diseases do that. I think that is what disease is. I think it is a call back to meaning and relation. And whatever you think is going on in the world, we aren't doing that. We're still avoiding it in your reverse communion, which sounds like reverse cowgirl, but we can find people without masks on Grindr. Let's give reverse communion a shot.
Well, now that Pornhub is being shut down. So it's
a subset of the thing. Yeah. So to sit at home on the couch while poor people bring you things, to wait for an experimental gene therapy that you're going to take whilst not sitting with what health and meaning and vitality is in your life, and instead being in a situation of fear, those people will be destroyed, even if they somehow survive the end of the dominant, right? So it's kind of I see people's worldview in how they are with meaning. Obviously everyone does, but like in particular, the other thing for 2021 is in a universe of meaning, then disease is a communication, right?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it's a herald. I mean, when we die, death is the most meaningful thing in our entire, well, one of them, in our entire existence. You see what a meaning-filled experience it is. Because when you die, you are, as I was talking about the constitutive forces, you become the constitutive forces. You become woven into them. I mean, and what a way to go. You become woven into the forces of the universe that once created the bounded version of you. I mean, that's so profound, you know? And so disease, you know, and other life and death processes, accidents, whatever they may be, that brings that to us. It's like the announcement of the return into those forces. And so, yeah, it's really well said, you know, that it's a communication. I think I think that we, you know, when we die and we're in that extra space of being in those constitutive forces, we also do work, and then we recondense, we find the right place to like just put the pin in the map again. And I want to say, I don't know why I'm thinking I need to say this, but I want to say, like, death also doesn't make us invincible. And I want to just bring that up, because this is what we're up against. You know, in World War II, this is very dark, and I hesitate to even say it, but in World War II, you know, Hitler commanded people to use a form of execution which actually destroyed the ability of their soul, of people's souls, to be coherent after death and to reincarnate. So a lot of the people, millions of people that were killed with gas in World War II, still have their souls dispersed and are seeking to recondense. And a lot of people are trying to do work. Some spiritual people, not a lot, are trying to do work to recompose those souls for incarnation. But that is absolute cruelty. It's absolute cruelty. Yeah. So I cannot think of anything more horrifying. And he did it. He did it not just to kill those people or harm those people, but he did it to actually harm Christ and the Son itself. And the fact of the matter is, what we're up against now is something that's sort of like that. Yep. It's not the same thing quite, but what Ahriman wants is, you know, as above, so below. Ahriman wants as below, so above. Ahriman wants to turn the death realm into a realm of objects. He wants to turn everything that is spiritual to us into an object, a thing. He can't succeed, by the way, but he can succeed for like 1,000 years. And yeah. Do you want to die and keep coming back as a thing? I mean, that's what we're up against now. And that's the urgency. So let's just try and get this right. You know?
Yeah, and I would describe it gnostically, but that's again the overall narrative. Invitation or urgent invitation of what's happening is that these are the stakes. These are actually the stakes. They are, and for people to miss this is astounding to me. Yeah. I certainly won't be coming back as an object. I'll just hang out for a bit. If
you're coming back as a stapler, like, and you know it.
To phrase it that way allows you to see, allows you to see every aspect of it from the digital commodification of people to the rest of it is turning it into, it denatures it, it despirits it, it takes life out of the cosmos, and that's its goal, because it is a force of anti-life, right? Mm-hmm. But similarly, when you just said, well, let's try and get this right, this is almost the Bayo Kamalafe thing, the response to that isn't at least yet, I don't know, March on Washington, because that process hastens the despiritification of what's going on. The immediate stuff is in that Terrence Malick's Nutty Professor 2 Meet the Clumps, where you do it on the individual relational level, right? You support, grow, and resonate with the living field on in the level that you're in, or in the relational context you're in, so that it continues. That's that's what it is and how it's powered. So if you stop doing it, it ends. That's 100%. Like what it is.
Yeah, it's really beautiful. I mean, I know there are questions coming up, but I mean, just to say, like, you know, it is true. Like the black magic version is, if you absolutely destroy the existence of one person over multiple lifetimes and you create a true void in the universe, it destroys the entire universe, right? This has never happened before. But the opposite is true, which is that, like, if you actually just stand in your integrity and you try to greet people with interest and love and transcend these silly conflicts that we all get pulled into, all of us. I mean, you just did that solo show about clearing those out. We all get pulled into those. If we try to get past that and stand in our integrity and stand in this kind of love that is real, like, it does radiate out. I mean, in the same way as, like, if you turn your Wi-Fi off at night and you sleep better, your neighbor will also probably sleep better because you've turned your fucking thing off. You know what I mean? So you give to everybody around you when you do that. And it has a profound, profound effect. It would be great, actually, if a folk soul of a nation or a spirit, a giant sort of spirit elemental being could get it right through the cooperation of certain people. Because actually, if you just had one sort of collective spot on the earth doing it, it would really, like, hugely make a difference. So, I mean, that's some of the work that I think some people are being called to do right now, but do it in your own being, for sure.
Yeah. Anything like, do you have, priorities is the wrong words, but, like, just before we do questions and so on, having said all that, instead of setting it up, like, what are you? Yeah. I mean, mine are fields, right? So they're not, I mean, there's plenty of things I actually want to do, which would be nice, but that kind of, like, wanting thing is sort of separate to deepening, because now I'm president of it, like deepening the my engagement with permaculture in Tasmania, you know, getting, like, there are sort of trajectories that will happen regardless of the conditions. And I think that's right. What people want to do when they're here at the beginning of the year, rather than say, like, I would like to visit Machu Picchu.
right.
Like, you might be able to, but, like, what is it? What is that? What does that represent? What is the thing that Machu Picchu is? And it's like, I would like to experience the sacred in a physical and profound way that is probably outside the world story that I grew up in. So I would like an encounter with the sacred that is also exotic in the good sense, not necessarily an orientalizing way. Okay, cool. If you think at those level of, like, priorities for 2021, it will hopefully be less of the unremitting heartbreak that 2020 was of any people's plans. So it's like, drop down to a level of what the things that you previously wanted were manifestations of, like, what, how is that desire pursuit fulfilled? Identify what that desire is. So I've kind of got ones like that, which is a sort of an improvement of, or a deepening of relationality with independent food producers in Tasmania. And I can do that online if I'm banged up at home for 4 months, right? Same sort of thing with improvement in like, poultry husbandry and all that kind of stuff. I've kind of dropped down from the physical things of the outgoing dominant to the archetypal or desire based things, and that's, so give me a shot, something like that for you.
yeah. Well, I mean, first of all, just to say, like, I talked about this on the episode of my show with Peter Gray and Alkistis Dimick from Scholarly Imprint. Like, Alkistis was talking about dance and Peter was talking about, you know, his work with Babylon and how painful it was. And I was like, yes, but the thing is, you know, that she'll just select someone else if you guys don't do it. Right. So, like, so the painful, intense thing that you've been called to do that is, like, crazy. If you're like, oh yeah, I have this spiritual work, but I really just want to, you know, I really want to make a coloring book or something like that. You can go do that, but just know that when you over prioritize, like, that spiritual task is going to find another person to do it, right? So do you really want to let go of that? You know, but the converse of that, and what you're you know, part of the frame of that is, if you actually put the spiritual task first, it will create a kind of sheath around all the other things that you want to do. And you'll be able to actually complete them in a way that you're talking about, where it's like, maybe it won't be the exact way that you pictured it, but it will begin to unfold actually in the way that you desired it to begin with.
Yes.
Because yeah. you've prioritized properly and you've made transparent your desires to your spiritual being yeah. and all the other aspects of yourself. So that's the first thing. I mean, I think for me, you know, one of the big tasks this year, and I can't talk about my specific work, but is really looking into shape. The nature of shape. I know that sounds strange, but I'm going to talk about this. You know, I don't know when this is coming out as an actual
it's
episode.
Out now, basically.
Oh, okay, okay. So the you know, there's this really beautiful passage in the Bible where, and everybody knows the gist of it, which is that a bunch of people bring this woman to Christ and they're like, she's an adulteress, so should we stone her? And you know, the famous line, let he who is without sin throw the first stone. And I'm going to talk about this more in my episode, first episode of the year. But the hidden part in that people sort of skip past is that it says Christ is either with a stick or his finger writing on the earth. And there's no indication anywhere else in the Bible that Christ knows how to write. There's no, you know, and in fact, he's not writing. He's creating symbols that are actually inscribing the spiritual realm in the earth with something new. And they have to be symbols because otherwise they'll be intersected by the polluted forces that exist and inhere in language already. So part of what's up to us to do right now is to create a new shape of understanding that is not just language, and that is not based on all the things that we knew before. And some of that has to do with things that look familiar to us in magic, symbols and glyphs and these kinds of things. But some of it is actually entirely new. And so that's where I'm focusing a lot of my work right now. And I also think, honestly, this is such a, so read Mutual Aid by Dean Spade. I had Dean on my show. It's just a book about mutual aid, and it's just how to deal with community conflict. Like, you know, that's part of it too. It's something that you learn when you move from America to Ireland and you're walking down the street to, like, you know, you go, you're going to get a coffee and like you see a neighbor that you don't really know very well. And you have to be like, I live in Ireland now. I have to stand here and have a conversation with that person. This is not about me getting there on time. Like, this is about me living in Ireland and having a conversation with an Irish person as we're breathing Irish air. And so it's that kind of thing too. I would just work on holding those tensions of conflict and desire and all that kind of stuff. Because again, that's the reprioritization of the spiritual in your life yes. that makes everything else possible. So put the spirit first this year, no matter what. It doesn't mean you have to do it all the time. Nobody can. It's too exhausting to do that. But, you know, be someone that doesn't forget it. You know, be someone who never forgets that that's true. And that, I mean, really wraps back to just right in the beginning of this episode. You know, we were both upset and continue to be by the people that have just treated spirituality like a Mogwai that they bought at the store. You know, yeah. It's like the cute thing that it becomes uncontrollable because they don't know what to do with it. You can't forget. Like, it's always got to be in the forefront of your mind. And you've got to work on walking through the world in that way and yeah. not just, and it, again, it doesn't have to be some mind-blowing thing. You don't have to do magic all the time. And you don't have to be like some Aleister Crowley fractal noia psychopath who sees a pencil fall off the desk and be like, what does that mean? What's the significance of that? You know, you don't have to be like that either, because that's also wrong. But you just have to be someone who keeps that there. And everything will unfold for you in the way that it's meant to unfold. And if you die, you'll die healthy.
Correct. Absolutely. Die healthy. I like that. That's absolutely, yeah. I think this is what the new dominant looks like. It's seeing the spiritual or the archetypal first rather than the play out of it. And he says it doesn't have to be, it is easy. It's actually easy and you don't have to do it all the time, but you want it to be more challenging than it is. But that's, yeah, I like it. It's good. So I'm happy with how I've kind of archetypalized my goals for 2021. I think obviously each year brings its own kind of heartbreak, and this one is going to suck. I mean, you know, this is just what happens now. But it's going to suck differently to what most of us went through in 2020, where we had to lose a bunch of shit, right?
So, I mean, look, it's not going to suck for everybody. Also, just listen, like, you might be one of the people
for the whole time, right?
Right.
Especially when you return to like a sort of cosmic relational approach, you are free of the shit. Like whatever, as I said, you can be stuck at home or whatever.
Right.
You're free of it if you're operating from that level, and we just have to do that now. So funny, one of the things, I can't remember who it was, it's all these weird anthropological books I read, but one of the reads, so a Guatemalan Maya read of what actually happened to the Maya after they quote unquote collapsed or vanished or whatever, is they entered the spirit world. They could see the sort of impact of what was going on in the Americas. And they're like, we just aren't going to be in the physical for a while, for the most part. So that's where they went. And whatever you like in the materialist read of what happened, like where did the Maya go? How did they collapse? And it's all such an interesting mirror of how like materialist naturalism thinks bad things happen, because they guess climate change and disease and all this stuff. But nevertheless, they're just not there. And if you actually ask like the surviving Maya descendants, some of them will say, yeah, they went into the spirit world because it was going to be shit here. And whilst we can't necessarily do that, well, we can actually, but whilst that may not necessarily be your first choice, to operate from that kind of cosmic understanding of like, well, it's just going to be a bit rough for a bit. That's cool. We'll do it this way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great. That's great. I wanted to, first of all, I want to resist archetypalizing my goals.
I know I'm saying it to you,
but I do think like there's a
strategizing.
Lucasizing. I think that one of the things that you can do to do that is write down your goals. I want to write a book. I want to learn how to play the banjo. I want to do this. I want to do that. Right. Me or I, we or community, and all or cosmos. What does it give you? What does it give your community? Even though I hate that term, what does it give we? And what does it give the cosmos? And you'll notice that some of them are very lopsided. Some of them offer nothing to the cosmos at all, right? And so each of your goals should have that transparency of those levels. And even if they don't, if you think through to like create them, not to create some sort of crazy justification for the dumb, bad thing you want to do, like create TikTok, like nobody, what the fuck, but like, whatever. I was just thinking like nobody likes TikTok. They just hate life. But anyway, so you have this like leveling, you know, and if you create it, if you create the reason for the cosmos, actually that does something. That really does something, and it gives you a pathway, and it also makes things more realizable, because all our goals this year have to be woven through those three. There are probably more levels, but those three levels at least initially. And that will also purify your soul a little bit.
You just feel better, yeah. That's a way of reminding yourself to be in resonance with the living field rather than the cloud. Like if you're doing it that way, yeah. All right, anything else? Or do we want to do some questions?
Well, we can do the Q&A. Yeah, the TNA.
All right. So from Adrian, on the Christian theme, where is the place for forgiveness and redemption for those who are being led up the garden path, either now or in the afterlife? Part of the problem, in my opinion, seems to be the lack thereof in, I think, popular culture.
The lack of forgiveness in popular culture. Is that what's
being said? But it's also like, where is the place to forgive, though? I guess it's a forgive them, Father. Like,
Yeah. I mean, it is forgive everybody. I mean, I'm sorry. It's just that, like, there's no exception. It doesn't matter. And that, I mean, I've been someone who's been physically pretty horribly abused by certain people in my life, and it's my task to forgive them, you know? And that And if you don't think that that aligns you in a healthy way, then you need to reconfigure what forgiveness means to you,
yeah.
because it, you don't have the right concept of it. We focus so much on accountability, you know, and the one thing I'll add to this is, look, again, with that, let he who's without sin cast the first stone. What Christ showed in that moment to those people was that we all create each other's sins.
Yes. You know? Forgiveness is animist. It's relational, right?
Absolutely. Like
it belongs in relation. It belongs to the system of people. And I get why, because it's, you know, responding to different traumas. It isn't a return to, it doesn't reinstate someone into a position of power where they caused you harm. It is clearing harm from a system. It's clearing damage from a web of relation, right?
Yeah, and like you gave a great exercise for that. I think for me, the best exercise has been doing The Work by Byron Katie. It's just very profound. It shows you how you have created every situation. It doesn't mean person punches you. You're it's your fault. It yes. means that you've also enacted violence in the world, and do you want to actually take that out, right? So that's yes. what you're talking about.
If you put yeah. violence into the system, there is violence in the system. So it's kind of right. like that, yeah. Like it's not clear to me if someone's hurt you, if someone said something nasty to you, it's like, how do you make the universe better? If the problem is that nastiness has been said in the world, then why do you think the solution is to add more nastiness to the world? Like it's a... Yeah. So it's
the opposite. Thing. It's the opposite of that fucking meme, which we all thought, including me, was funny for a little while, where it's like the person carrying the sack on their back and they're like, I wish the world was a little better. And then there's the guy coming out of the well saying, oh, yet you participate in the world. I'm very smart. You know, actually, he's right. Like, yeah. That's the problem. That's the problem with that meme. He's actually correct. He doesn't have the right path of action afterwards, but he's correct in saying, well, we all actually created this. And so the idea that, you know, this dumb idea, oh, well, sure, we're all in capitalism. So we all like, you know, yeah, no shit. You actually are culpable for the capitalism that you're in. And I know that that sucks and it's a bitter pill to swallow, but you don't get out of it by directly confronting it all the time. You have to do all different kinds of things. And that also doesn't mean don't act towards dismantling it.
No, but yes, act in a way that works. So that's the accelerationist thing that I like, that it's developed a sufficient robustness as a system that it automatically contains anything that approaches it adversarially. So you right. kind of have to sneak in. It has to be an oblique approach. And that's the what if the way we respond to the crisis is part of the crisis. It's that war story, right? Anything that you just, whatever you do, this is an Eisenstein quote, but like, don't contribute to the field of war. Like that's that's what it is, right? Next one from Anonymous. What particular spiritual beings are looking to ally with us through this process? Relationally, I would say that is definitionally not something you can say universals about.
Oh, yeah. I mean, maybe the only universal I would add is all of them. Yeah. Like because even the adversarial forces, I mean, the trick about evil is that it wants to be redeemed, but it only knows its one path. So even that's in collaboration with us. And so when you were saying before, what if when you were talking about your guest, I forget his name, but that was a great episode, you know, that our response to the crisis is part of the crisis. I would just take that further and say our response to the crisis is the crisis. Like anything can arise. And if we greet it properly and we know how to, you know, build the right sort of home for it or nest for it or heart for it, it exists in the right way. So all the beings are seeking to collaborate with us, every single one of them. Yeah.
If we you do get it in the little corners of Christianity and like grimoire work and so on, but it's self-evident in places like India that if it exists, it's supposed to exist. So like the malefic or hostile spiritual forces aren't wrong. There's no such thing as a wrong existence. Like if right. it exists, yeah. it's in that web of agreements that makes up the entire universe. So it would be that kind of thinking of like what being is seeking to help us is back to that solutionistic thing. Now there are some, but it's contextual. So if you live on a little farm in Uruguay or if you're a Bon shaman or whatever, the relationality, you are in relation to different aspects of the cosmos there. And in fact, right. it's that universalizing that is that solutionism that is in fact part of the crisis. So you can't just say, although this is still true, and you would probably agree, you can't just say St. Michael and be like, done, next question. Whilst that is true, it's the wrong kind of true for the new dominant.
Yeah, totally. I mean, if you eat the wrong mushroom, you die, right? Yeah. So like, you can't eat all mushrooms. Like, some of them are poisonous, and that doesn't mean that the poisonous ones have no value. I mean, it's just true. And the, I mean, it's the cheesiest moment in Contact, right? Where the aliens reach out to Jodie Foster and they're her dad. And they're like, we thought this would make it easier for you. It makes a difference what you see, you know, even if there's some similar force streaming through, like it makes a difference what you see on a feeling level and, you know, changes things. That's why some people are afraid of angels when they see them. And some people are very happy to see them. You know, the countenance has a different effect on different people. So, and that matters because we matter.
One of the few fun internet things of 2020 was the return of biblically accurate depictions of angels, like the all eyes and feathers and whatever. I loved it.
From a window, the cover From a Window to the Door by Madeline Alingal, that weird feather eyeball being on the cover of the 80s edition. That's what angels look like to some people. Now me, they're generally actually quite comforting. I mean, I encounter the angel of death and I'm like, oh, there, that's nice. But that's because I have a Christian pathway. This is just very different from other people. But sometimes they're fucking scary to people. The travelers here, the indigenous ethnic group in Ireland, angels are fucking scary as shit to them, you know? So the fairies, you know, who are kind of mean to other Irish people, you know, not so scary to travelers.
Next one, any advice for some of us that despite being here, don't have weird new health issues recently and don't feel like we've got a pursuit other than making a coloring book? Thanks both. the meaning quest. Now here's the thing. It's nested. We have built, this is an inertia of culture thing that we assume we are born into a world where we have to go and discover our meaning. And it's one of those things that's kind of incorrectly true, because you do, but if you think that means like a gringo vision quest where you have to go and like discover yourself somewhere, you'll end up getting the Paulo Coelho treatment of just going there and finding out that the thing you wanted was back home. Like, so I'm prefacing by saying that, because what I mean to say is that you encountering the meaning extant in the universe and its implications in your own life is work you have to do regardless of whether it's 2021 and we have to deal with this, you know, technocratic reorganization of reality and so on. You'd have to do that anyway, even if we were facing benign times. So the advice is to sit with how you understand meaning, where you think it is and what you think a life is for, rather than, again, like, you know, although you should meditate daily just from a health perspective, like you won't get it by sitting on a mountaintop, because that's solutionistic. Like, you might get it by sitting on a mountaintop, but that can't be the prescription.
Yeah. I mean, it's just sort of like, no offense to person asks this, but have some guts to ask what you want. What do you want?
There you go.
What do you want? Start there. Yeah. And don't frame what you want around what you don't want. What do you actually want? You know, that's where to start.
I like it. Connor, this is from Sam. Connor, would you mind recapping your interpretation of Christ writing with his finger in the earth and how it was arrived at? I'm not getting it from the passage referred to. How did you get there?
Yeah, I'll do that on the next episode of my show.
Okay, there you go.
Then we can move past that one. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, very good. All right, so that's the last question. We have 90 minutes. It's a little bit
longer. Oh, really? I skipped the last question. Do we have one more? Wasn't there always a person that always asked the last question? Maybe, I guess that person's not here.
Oh, Kelsey, I don't know if they're in the chat. They yeah. Okay. They got a kid in a weird job. So
okay. Okay, got it. Yeah, well,
what else do we need to say?
I felt like there was something else that we needed to say. And no, I
don't. The notes you sent through on WhatsApp were like, I have some thoughts on the astral and the Bible. And I'm like, maybe that's a whole separate show.
I already talked about the Bible part, and the astral part was the birds thing, like the sort of reworking of the astral. I mean, I think the only thing I would say here at the end is what part of the work that we've been talking about for a while now, you and I, Gordon, is constellating around sort of different spots of the earth, you know, like groups of people, you know, that are their own stars that form kinds of constellations that send a different kind of light into the cosmos, but on the face of the earth. I think now part of what we need to do is create a new circulatory system for the earth. And part of that involves puncturing these communities so that they bleed and so that they know that they're not stones, because you can't get blood from a stone. And watching that flow. And so in many ways, I would say a picture to carry forward is that the 2020 is a year of the significance of the revelation of blood. So just take that with you.
All right. I like it. All right. That'll be good. And I mean, I guess, where do people find you? I'm reasonably confident they know, but we should, you know, finish the show in an official capacity, I guess. And what you got coming up and all the rest of it.
Against Everyone with Connor Habib is my podcast. And my Patreon is patreon.com/ConnorHabib. And there's lots of cool stuff on there, including access to stuff like this. I have a novel coming out, but I think it got pushed forward a bit, which is good because the fall of 2021 is going to be kind of weird. So it'll be 2022. So in even sort of weirder time, but I think it'll be better. That novel's
protected. Oh, you mean pushed forward? So like, I thought you meant pulled forward, but you mean pushed into 2022.
Exactly. Yeah. So it's called Hawk Mountain, and it is a sort of very sorrowful.
Not even Professor to meet the clumps, but done with dogs.
Exactly. Hawk Mountain, not Dog Mountain. Hawk Mountain. And so, yeah, it's a very bloody, violent, gruesome, and sad story. So,
yeah, enjoy that when it comes to 2022.
Exactly. But it's old world. It's old world, bloody, violent sadness. And my Twitter is at Connor Habib. And that's it, really. That's all I really use anymore. God knows how I even manage that. But it's okay.
Well, by the next time we do this, assuming we don't end up having to do emergency broadcasts like we did in 2020. who knows if you'll even include Twitter by the time we're doing this in 2022. In 50 years' time.
What a blessing. What a fucking blessing. Right. if the global crisis can destroy social media and sports, I'm good.
Yeah. Then you're gonna join the Davos class. Yeah.
Thanks right, everybody for listening.
Thanks so much. These are always super fun. So I was looking forward to it for weeks. So I'm enjoying the continuation of our tradition.
Awesome. And I'm excited to read your book.
Yay. All right. I'm going to hit the stop.